Welcome to a new episode of my high-performance Java persistence video course. In this episode, we are going to talk about JPA and Hibernate entity identifiers. First, we will talk about database primary keys and why synthetic identifiers are usually preferred. Next, we will discuss all JPA identifier generators, identity, sequence, table, and auto. In a relational database, the primary key is used to uniquely identify a table row. When it comes to choosing a primary key, there are basically two options, a natural or a surrogate key. A natural key, like a social security number, vehicle identification number, or a book ISBN, is assigned by a central organization who guarantees that no two natural keys are identical. The major problem with a natural key is its size. In order to be unique, the natural ID is rather long. The social security number has 9 digits. A book ISBN used to have 10 digits. Nowadays, it has 13. The vehicle identification number is composed of 17 alphanumeric characters. Therefore, to ensure their uniqueness, a natural key is going to be long, and that can take a significant amount of space in the database. It's not just that the primary key will occupy all this space, but all the associated foreign keys linking back to this particular natural identifier primary key will be long as well. So, the extra space issue is amplified by child tables. The alternative is to use a surrogate key, like a UUID or an auto-incremented numeric sequence. The UUID suffers from the same issue as natural keys. Taking 128 bits, it's quite large. On the other hand, an auto-incremented numeric column can be much more compact. Depending on how many rows you need to insert into the table, you can choose either a tiny int, which takes 1 byte and allows you to store 256 rows, a small int, which takes 2 bytes, so you can store 65,000 rows, or an int, which takes 4 bytes, so you can store 4 billion rows, a big int, which takes 8 bytes, and you won't ever run out of identifier values. The more compact the identifier, the less space it will take to store a row on disk or in memory when the associated page is stored in the database buffer pool. But it's not just the page containing the row that's impacted by column size, the indexes are affected as well. And when it comes to primary and foreign keys, you'll probably want to index all these keys to speed up queries involving the primary or the foreign keys. In MySQL, secondary indexes reference the primary key, so if the primary key is large, all secondary indexes will be affected as well. Numeric identifiers are more suitable for clustered indexes as well. A clustered index is an index-organized table, meaning that the table itself is stored as an index, where the primary key is used to build the index. The most common relational database index, the B-tree, is a self-balancing tree data structure, meaning that when the keys are added in random order, there is going to be a lot of fragmentation and page splits. However, when using sequential numeric values, records are always appended at the end of the clustered index, so the physical ordering of the index pages is going to match the logical ordering of the index nodes. Therefore, searching a range of primary keys, like it's the case for keyset pagination, can be done sequentially and is going to be very fast. If the primary key values are scattered all over the entire index tree, the physical page ordering is going to be different than the logical ordering of the index nodes, so scanning the index will incur more random I/O than sequential reads, so it's going to be slower. In JPA and Hibernate, every entity must have an identifier. Most often, the underlying table primary key column is mapped to the entity identifier. The identifier can be manually assigned, or it can be automatically generated by the JPA provider. There are three basic strategies to generate identifiers automatically. Identity, using a database identity column. Sequence, using a database sequence generator. Table, emulating a database sequence using a separate table. When using auto, Hibernate chooses one of the three aforementioned identifier generator strategies. The assigned identifier lacks the generated value annotation, so the user must supply a unique value whenever a new entity is to be persisted. In this case, we can use the book ISBN number as an identifier, since it's both unique and immutable. The ISBN number must be supplied by the application developer when persisting the entity, as well as when fetching the entity. The identity column type is included in the SQL 2003 standard. It's supported traditionally by SQL Server and MySQL, and Oracle supports it since version 12c. The identity generator can only be applied to a single column in a table, and the column value can be assigned automatically to the current value of an internal counter that gets incremented every time it is invoked. The incrementation process is very efficient, since it uses a lightweight locking mechanism. More, the counter is not transactional, so rollbacks can lead to gaps between the identity column values of two consecutive table rows. However, this is not a bug, it's actually a feature. Because it's non-transactional, the counter can release locks right away after its internal value was incremented. The entity identifier mapping to an identity column is done via the identity strategy of the generated value annotation. Now, when persisting one entity, Hibernate is going to use the default keyword for the primary key, and the database is going to allocate a new value after incremented the identity column counter. The only drawback is that the newly assigned value can only be known after the actual insert statement is executed. Because Hibernate separates the ID generation from the actual entity insert statement, entities using the identity generator cannot be inserted in batches. That's because the insert statement is executed right away when the persist method is called, therefore breaking the transactional right behind caching semantic used for delaying SQL statements. By the time the persistence context is flushed and entity state changes are ready to be synchronized with the database, the inserts were already issued, so there's no way Hibernate can batch them at this point. A sequence is a database object that generates numbers upon incrementing an internal counter. The same sequence can be used to populate multiple columns, even across tables. Or you can use it to generate unique values that can be used by the application outside of the relational database. Allowing incremental steps, a sequence can benefit from application-level optimization techniques. Because the sequence call can be decoupled from the actual insert statement, entities can be inserted in batches during the persistence context flush operation. The entity identifier mapping to a sequence database object is done via the sequence strategy of the generated value annotation. Now, when persisting one entity, Hibernate is going to call the sequence to fetch the value used for populating the primary key. When the persistence context is flushed, the insert statement already contains the primary key value. Just like identity columns, database sequences use dedicated locks to prevent concurrent transactions from acquiring the same value. Since locks are released right after incrementing the associated counter, a gap can occur between the primary key values of two consecutive table rows. As explained before, this is not a problem since primary key values need to be unique, not to form series of consecutive integer values. This design ensures minimal contention, even when the sequence is accessed by multiple concurrent transactions. JPA offers an alternative sequence value generator that works even when the database sequence objects are not natively supported. A database table is used to hold the latest sequence value, and row-level locking is employed to prevent two concurrent connections from acquiring the same identifier value. The entity identifier mapping to a table-based sequence generator is done via the table strategy of the generated value annotation. For the table identifier generator, Hibernate is going to use a separate database table to hold the current sequence value. When persisting an entity, the current value is fetched while also locking the underlying table generator record. If the table generator does not find any associated record, one is being added with a start value of 1. After getting the current sequence value, the counter is incremented using a separate update statement. Using a database table as a sequence is challenging because to prevent two transactions from getting the same sequence value, row-level locking must be used. But unlike the sequence object locks, a row-level lock is transactional, and once acquired, it can only be released when the current transaction ends, either by issuing a commit or a rollback. To cope with this limitation, a separate database transaction is used for fetching a new sequence value. This way, the row-level lock associated with the sequence counter value incrementation process can be released as soon as the identifier value is returned to the calling thread. For resource local transactions, a new transaction implies acquiring a separate database connection, disabling the autocommit flag, executing the sequence processing logic, and finally committing this secondary database transaction. This can put additional pressure on the underlying connection pool, especially if there is already a significant contention for database connections. In a JTA environment, the current running transaction must be suspended and the sequence value is fetched in a separate transaction. The calling transaction is resumed after the new sequence value is acquired. For most JDBC drivers, it's not possible to multiplex multiple transactions on the same physical database connection. So, most often, even if the calling transaction is suspended, the new transaction will still require a new database connection from the pool. Therefore, to accommodate the transaction context switch, the JTA transaction manager has to do additional work, which can have an impact on the overall application performance. The auto-generator can be supplied either explicitly or implicitly by omitting the strategy attribute of the generated value annotation. What identifier generator is chosen depends on the Hibernate version in use. Prior to Hibernate 5, the auto-identifier strategy was associated with the native Hibernate-specific generator. The native generator will pick identity if the database supports identity columns or sequence otherwise. This can be a problem for databases like PostgreSQL or Oracle 12c, since to benefit from batch inserts, you'd want to use sequence objects, even if identity columns are supported as well. Since Hibernate 5, the auto-generator falls back to using the Hibernate sequence style generator, which works as follows. If the underlying database supports sequences, the sequence generator will be used. Otherwise, the table generator is going to be employed. However, this new Hibernate 5 behavior is not desirable for a database like MySQL, as long as sequence objects are not supported natively. So, to avoid falling back to a table generator, you are better off instructing Hibernate to use the native generator instead, as Hibernate is going to pick the identity generator and not the table one. So, when inserting the same three post entities on MySQL, Hibernate is going to issue the following SQL insert statements. Notice that the use of the default keyword is database specific. For instance, Hibernate will use it for hypersonic, but omit it for MySQL. Nevertheless, Hibernate used the identity generator instead of the table one, since we explicitly opted for the native identifier generator. The goal of the table generator was to address portability issues when having to support multiple relational databases. However, overriding the default identifier generator is a much more efficient way to address this portability issue. The identifier overriding is possible because XML mappings can override the annotation-based ones. Testing time. Go to my high-performance Java Persistence GitHub repository and open the PostgreSQL identifier test. This test imports a single post entity whose identifier mapping uses a JPA sequence generator. Now let's go back to our unit test, which inserts 5 post entities. When running this test on PostgreSQL, we can see that the post entity identifier uses a database sequence called Hibernate sequence. If we do the same for MySQL and open the MySQL identifier test, we can see that the same post entity is being used. The resource section where we can supply custom XML mapping is commented out. When running this test, we can see that, on MySQL, Hibernate has picked the table generator for this post entity, which defines a sequence identifier. However, we want to avoid this generator, since, as already explained, it does not scale very well. Therefore, to fix this issue, we are going to uncomment the resources section. The MySQL ORM XML file contains just an identifier mapping which instructs Hibernate to use the identity generator. Because XML mappings override annotation-based ones when rerunning our test, we can see that instead of table, Hibernate is going to choose the identity generator, as instructed by the XML mapping, which has overridden the one declared by the annotation in the postEntity class. That's it. You can have identifier portability even without the table generator. If you like this video, you are going to love my high-performance Java persistence video course. For more details, go to my blog vladmihalcha.com and check out the courses page. If you're struggling with data access performance issues, this video course will teach you how to get the most out of JPA and Hibernate. You have unlimited access to the course material and 14 days money-back guarantee. If you are curious what other people think about the video course lessons, then you should definitely read the testimonials I got from my students. Thank you for watching this video and enjoy running your data access layer at high speeds.